think so. So she gets me hooked up. Hello, 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 hello. Testing, 1, 2, 3. Testing, 1, 2, 3. Testing, 1, 2, 3. Testing, 1, 2, 3. So, where do I put this? Right here?
Good morning. Is there any place you'd rather be than at worship this morning? Amen.
Amen.
All right. Do a quick sports report. Get the bad one out of the way first. Nebraska is awful. I mean, they are just terrible. There was about 2 good plays on their side of the ball all day yesterday. It's pretty bad. It's tough to watch. Anyway, you and I. Iowa State, though, right? Victory, and then the old Hawkeyes, they took care of business yesterday as well. So at least 2 of the 3 teams in the state won, right? So if you're a visitor here with us this morning, there should be a card in the pew someplace next to you. It looks like the one that's on the screen there. We're just so thankful to have you here. If you'd fill that out and take it out to our welcome desk after service, they'll get you a mug. It's got a bunch of good information about our church in there. Out by the office out here, we got a glove box. If you haven't heard, with winter coming kind of early this year, there's a lot of kids that maybe aren't super fortunate in the school system, missing gloves, hats, scarves, things like that to keep them warm. There's a box out here. We're getting that over to the elementary school every single week. That way we can divvy up those items as fast as we can to kids that are in need of them. So if you have some laying around, new, used, as long as they're in pretty decent shape, we're happy to take those. If you have any questions, you can see Barry Eike. He's waving over here. He'll get you some more information on that. There should be a screen popping up here for our donation drop-off for Operation Christmas Child, November 18th through the 25th. Those are your times. I'm not going to read all those off. We'll have some more information on that, hopefully, at Children's Message today. Off-year Christmas party is happening again. We are in need of a turkey or a ham. So if you're planning on coming to that, you don't even have to cook it. We just need to donate it. Susan Herman, she's going to be doing all the cooking for that. So if you're interested in that event, you can contact Kat in the office, or interested in donating a turkey or ham, you can get with her or Susan Herman. And we'll get you all taken care of that way. Awaiting the already is our church Advent study starting next week. Sign-ups are out in the narthex. We haven't had too many people sign up yet, so let's get up on that. Get ready to rumble. If you're interested in signing up to lead a group, I think you can still do that as well. So if you have a group of people, if you meet for coffee or whatever and want to do a Bible study church-wide, the sermons on Sundays are going to be kind of following along with that study as well. So it's a really cool study that's going to be coming up starting next week. And then last but not least, if you would like to purchase a poinsettia to decorate the sanctuary at Christmas time, we need those orders in by December 4th. Let us set our hearts and minds for worship.
Let us pray together this ancient prayer. Jesus, my feet are dirty. Come even as a slave to me. Pour water into your bowl. Come and wash my feet. In asking such a thing, I know I am overbold, but I dread what was threatened when you said to me, if I do not wash your feet, I have no fellowship with you. Wash my feet then, because I long for your companionship. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried.
He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended to the heaven. Is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
As we have received grace and love in Jesus Christ, let us share Christ's peace with one another.
From Psalm 40. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, who does not look to the proud, to those who turn aside to false gods. Many, Lord my God, are the wonders you have done, the things you planned for us. None can compare with you. Were I to speak and tell of your deeds, they would be too many to declare.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. How are we today? Good. Thumbs up. Well, I brought a helper with me today. I think all of you guys know Caleb, but I asked him to come up here today because he is one of our confirmation students. We've got several in the crowd today. And in confirmation, that's a time where those kids who are about in middle school learn more about our church, and they really dig in and learn more about their faith. And each of those kids is asked to pick out a verse from the Bible that means a lot to them. And so I asked Caleb to come today to share his confirmation verse. So Caleb, can you tell us what it is?
My confirmation verse is Matthew 28, verse 19. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
When did you first hear this verse?
It was in a Sunday school song that we sang one time, and I really enjoyed it.
So I know some of you love it when we play songs during Sunday school and get to sing and dance. And others are giving me this look like, not so much right now. But Caleb loves music. And so this verse really spoke to him when he heard it. Are any of you in second grade right now? Janelle's in second grade. So he was probably about Janelle's age, right around your guys' age when he first heard this song. So that's how old he was when he first heard it. What did it mean to you then?
I just thought it was a fun song to listen to. I didn't really know what it meant until later.
So why does that verse still stick with you now? What's it mean to you now?
Now it means to not just keep God's love inside of you. You need to share it with everybody, no matter what you're doing.
So we need to share God's love. And there's so many different ways that we can do that, whether you're your age, whether you're young, whether you're my age, whether you're the seasoned adults in this room. But oftentimes when we hear those words, go therefore and make disciples, and we hear that word go, I think oftentimes, in our adult minds anyway, we oftentimes think of people who go out and are missionaries. Maybe they leave home and they go travel to another country to tell other people about God, which is awesome. But we don't all have to be missionaries leaving our home completely and traveling to another country. We can share our love of God and Jesus in so many ways. So, I have a question. How many of you were here yesterday when we had our packing party for Operation Christmas Child? Only a couple weren't, but I know these people have been here before, and I know they're still packing boxes. You guys have all been part of this before. So, we packed lots and lots of shoe boxes yesterday. And that's just one way that we can go and tell other people about Jesus. Because even though you guys don't know the little boy or little girl who's going to receive those shoeboxes that you packed yesterday, you guys are the first step in getting that box to that child. So again, you're not going to talk to that child personally, but you packed a shoebox that somebody else, a minister or a teacher in their community, is going to be able to use to give to that child. And when they give them that shoebox, they also tell them about Jesus and Jesus' love for them. So while you may not talk to that person directly, you are taking that first step in go by packing that shoebox. Now, I know there are lots of people in this room, and probably some of you guys as well, who want to know how many shoeboxes we packed yesterday. Okay, if you already know, you can't guess or tell us quite yet. I want to hear if we have any guesses as to how many boxes we packed. Casey, how many do you think?
Maybe around, I saw a lot of the bigger boxes packed. Should I say maybe 1,000?
Maybe 1,000. Let me tell you that last year, I'll give you some help here. Last year we packed 856 shoe boxes. You should have seen Henick's eyes just now, ladies and gentlemen. We packed, so over 850 last year, and we packed more this year. Okay, Henick, do you want to take a guess?
206,005,000.
Oh my gosh. I don't know if we'd have room in the church for that many. Okay, I'm going to take one or two more guesses.
851.
851? No, it was actually more than that. One more guess, Austin.
859.
859. That would be more than our 856. You know what? Casey was a little bit closer, although she went over, so if she was playing Price is Right, she wouldn't win. we had the accounting firm of Stock, Stocks, and Clemen who were trying to verify our numbers. They may not be hired back next year, but they finally determined that we collected how many, Caleb?
987.
That was awesome, and I'm still always amazed that in just 2 hours, we got all those boxes packed, and then half an hour to clean up, and most people were out of here by 11:30, noon at the latest. It was pretty amazing. But now that we've collected all those boxes, you guys know that it costs a little bit of money to ship those boxes, and so we've been announcing that we're going to have a noisy offering today, so I need your help yet again. I would like you guys to help us collect our noisy offering to see if we can raise some more of the shipping costs to ship these boxes around the world, okay? So I'm going to give you guys cans, and while you guys are collecting your money, they are going to play the video, the song that inspired Caleb's confirmation verse. And then we've got some pictures from the packing party as well, okay? So once you are done, bring your money up here and then stay up here for me too, okay? So again, you can enjoy some of the photos as we finish up down here as well. Before you kids go, I want us to circle around. I want everybody to grab one of the shoeboxes that's around here, and you can stay out there if you want to. Yep, plenty over here. So yeah, you guys can all gather back up here if you want to. I want you guys to look at the tags. Do you have a girl or a boy? I want you guys to picture in your head, if you have a girl box, think of what that girl might look like. And if you have a boy box, think of what that boy might look like. How old do you think they are? What do they look like? What are they wearing right now? Is their hair long or short? What color are their eyes? Because you know what? We may not know exactly who that child is, but God knows exactly who that child is. Because just as God created you to be your unique self, he created that child as well. So what I want to do right now is we're going to pray for these children and all the children who are going to be receiving their shoeboxes this year. Okay, can you bow your heads for me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you sent your son to be our Savior. We thank you that you created us to be each unique individuals, and we pray for the children who are going to receive these shoeboxes. Thank you for allowing us to serve you, to be the very first step in this process as we go out and tell others about you, whether it's across the world or whether it's our friends and neighbors in our own backyard. You are so special, and we want to share your love with all those around us. In your name we pray. Amen.
I get to read the scripture from 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. John writes, "Dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. This is how you can recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God, but every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming, and even now is already in the world." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, it is a delight to be here with you this morning. I bring greetings to you from our bishop, Lori Haller. She extends her greetings to you and always covets your prayers as we face many interesting transitions in the past several months. Bishop Lori will be with us on the district this coming Tuesday at 6:30 at First Church Cedar Falls. She'll be sharing with our district her vision for the future of the United Methodist Church in, say, 10 to 15 years. It's a fascinating look into the future, and I think it's something that you might enjoy hearing about. So you're certainly welcome, all of you, to attend. That's Tuesday, 6:30 in Cedar Falls. I'm glad to be with you this morning. Pastor Phil invited me to preach a while back. He plans ahead. He really does plan ahead. He's a planner. And I wish he wished he'd done a little more planning on that Nebraska football game. We go way back, Phil and I, to Cedar Rapids, where we both served as pastors, and we both worked with the youth groups in our churches. He at St. Paul's and I at Lovely Lane. And we had a couple projects that we worked together, and we always had really interesting dialogues about Nebraska and Iowa football, as you can imagine. Too bad I'm not here to gloat this. Too bad he isn't here to have me gloat, and that may be exactly why he is where he is. He's in a duck blind somewhere, I imagine, and having a great time, and we wish him well and a well-deserved rest. So my understanding is you've been looking at the Apostles' Creed for the last three Sundays. You've probably learned that the Apostles' Creed is a Trinitarian creed, so each paragraph deals with a different person of the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. So it's a great three-week sermon series. But here I am on the tail end, the fourth Sunday, and I'm sort of bringing up the rear to talk a little bit about the need for creeds, why this creed is still relevant today, why it's important for us to understand and study these ancient creeds. Let me begin by just telling you a story. Back when I was in seminary, The third year of our seminary experience was an internship, and I was interning in a little cow town of Mason, Texas. Now, my supervisor was the chair of the staff parish relations committee there in Mason, and her name was Doris Grody. I was about 22 years old and pretty green and still learning the ropes in ministry. I was about halfway through my seminary career. Doris recognized this right away, and she gave me a lot of good advice. We grew close in the 7 months that I spent in that church. And one day, Doris says to me, now Doris was a bank teller. She was about old enough to be my mom. She was kind of a surrogate mom in some ways and supervisor as well, which kind of goes together, right? Mother, supervisor, yeah, that makes sense. She's kind of a petite lady, well-dressed, always had her hair put up just right. And it surprised me one day when she told me that she was also a rattlesnake hunter. Doris Grody began hunting rattlesnakes when her children, she had three boys, when her boys were just knee-high and were running around barefoot on their ranch in the yard around the house, she came home from church one day and found a rattler curled up on the front porch. That's when Mama Bear mode came, and she began to hunt those rattlesnakes down all over her property. Now, she didn't just hunt them and kill them. Her husband, Oliver, gave her a special hatchet. It was a hatchet that was welded onto a 10-foot pole because he would go with her, and she would rope these rattlesnakes, and then he would stand and go chop and chop their heads off. He said he needed a 10-foot pole and no shorter than that. So she had this special hatchet. And now she didn't waste a thing. She would send the head to a globe company down in Houston, and they would put it in a globe and sell that rattlesnake head, you know. And then she would skin the rattlers, and she would soak them in antifreeze and to preserve them. And then she'd make belt buckles out of them, and she'd make hat bands, and she put the little rattles on those hat bands. And man, the cow guys out there, those cowboys out there loved that. She would sell those. She even would bleach the bones and make necklaces out of the rattlesnake bones and sell those. And of course, the meat made a wonderful chicken salad dip, which I had unknowingly several times before she told me that I was eating rattlesnake. One day she asked me, Paul, would you like to go rattlesnake hunting with me? And I said, well, of course, right? Who would want to miss out on that? So I said, sure. So we went out to her ranch, and what she would do is she'd go out in the spring while it was still a little cool, and those critters were down in their burrows hibernating. And she would pump some gas down in those holes. And those snakes, now, you may want to shield your children's ears, but down there, they taught that if you saw a rattler and you didn't kill it, you got a spanking. That's how they treat rattlers down there. They are a threat to their cattle, so they will do anything to protect their cattle. So she pumps this gas down these rattlesnake holes, and these poor creatures would come on up, kind of, ooh, what's going on? And she'd hook them and lop off their heads, and that's the end of them. So there I was there with the hook. I had this tube, it was a tube with a metal rod that went up and then it had a hook on the end, and the tube had sort of a flat place on it, and you would put it around the snake and then you'd pull that rod back and that would hook them, and you could hold them that way, and then she could chop off their heads. Okay, so that was the plan. So I'm sitting outside this, I'm sitting down by this hole watching, waiting for this horrible poisonous snake to come out and wait for him to get out far enough to grab him. While I'm waiting, nothing's happening, and we're waiting and talking. All of a sudden, I noticed that we were sitting next to a rock wall. Now, out there, they don't make fences out of a barbed wire. They just use the rocks because there's lots of them, and they build walls for the cattle. Well, here in the midst of this rock wall, there was this rock that was moving slowly. And it was a big, fat rattlesnake that had entwined itself in the rocks. And it was like this big round, and it was about this long, and it had been in the sun, and it was not hibernating, and it was awake, and it was moving. And I said, "Doris, why is that rock moving?" And Doris says, "Oh, that's a big one. Get him about that far behind his head." So I said, "Okay." And I took that pole, which is about 4 feet long, not nearly long enough, 4 feet long. I slid it under his belly, and I went, and when I did that, that snake reared up, and it went with its tail, and it pulled back in the rocks and wedged itself in there, and I was in this tug of war with this snake. Now, snake was like turning on it and biting this pole that was not nearly long enough, and there was venom, drops of venom flying around. And I was like, Doris, how are you going to chop off its head yet? No, you got to pull it out. Play it like a fisherman. Just wait till he relaxes and then pull him out. Well, I'm not a fisherman. I've never been fishing, and I was not getting this. I would yank on him, and that hook would just kind of move down closer to his head and closer to slipping off, and I did not want to be around when that creature got loose. Well, this slippage and this pulling back, and Doris was kind of laughing back. I heard her snickering back there, and I'm in a life and death struggle here, and finally that hook gets down to right about on its head, and I said, "Doris, I don't think I can hold this guy any longer. We got to do something. Are we going to run?" And she said, "No, you just hold on him. Now listen, Pastor Paul, I believe in you. Are you going to hold on to him?" I said, "Yes, I will. I'll hold on him. Don't you let him go." "All right. I believe in you, Pastor Paul," she says. And then she pulls out of her pocket a pocket knife with a blade about that long. And she goes over to that snarling snake that's yanking and tugging and war with me. And she says, "Now, I believe in you, Pastor Paul." And she begins to saw on the neck of that snake. "You just hang on to him, you hear? I believe in you, Pastor Paul." Well, she finally got through that snake. It took an endless amount of time, but that snake went limp, stopped doing that thing, and things calmed down. And I learned two things that day. First of all, that was the first time anybody ever called me Pastor Paul, so I remember that. The other thing I remember is that she believed in me and what belief means. I believe in Latin, the word is credo. That's how you say "I believe" in Latin, credo. And that's where we get the word creed. Most creeds begin with those words. I believe in this, I believe in that. The Apostles' Creed that you've been looking at was actually not in its final form until about 700 AD. But bits and pieces of it had been around for nearly 700 years. It had been used for teaching in the early church. And we have papyri, we have manuscripts that show the teaching of some of the earliest disciples and even some of the apostles. And even as you go into the New Testament and look around, you will find references and you'll find allusions to some of the same beliefs there that are in the Apostles' Creed. So we call it the Apostles' Creed, even though it didn't take the shape that it has until 700 AD, because its guts formed in the crucible of the early years of the church when the apostles were taking the gospel in all many different directions. Now, why was the Apostles' Creed written? Well, the context was there was a lot of confusion in the early church. You know, the disciples and the apostles, they were taking the gospel in every direction, to Spain and all throughout the Mediterranean world. They took it to Iran and to what now India, all over. It spread like wildfire. But as it spread across different languages,
different cultures and then across different generations with time, well, the message sometimes got changed just a little bit. Have you ever played that game Telephone? Right? Where you start and you whisper the message into your neighbor's ear, and then they whisper the message and it goes around the circle. And by the time you come around to the other side of the circle, what was said in the beginning and what you hear at the end is sometimes a bit different, isn't it? That's what was happening in the ancient world. There was some confusion. There's confusion among people about, well, exactly who is this guy Jesus? What did he do? What's his relationship with God? Is he a human? Is he divine? There are all kinds of questions about Jesus. And you have to realize, too, that this gospel was not shared in a vacuum. That there were all kinds of other religions going on, and they were all polytheistic. And oftentimes what would happen, as with Paul when he preached to the Greeks in Athens, you remember in the book of Acts, he preached to a bunch of Greek philosophers in the Areopagus. And they listen to him and they give him a fair hearing and they say, we'd like to hear you again. But you could tell that for most of them, this was just one more story, one more belief in a whole bunch of different philosophies and theologies and religions that were circulating through the Mediterranean world at that time. And what people would often do, because they were not monotheistic, and by that I mean they didn't believe that there was only one God, they often would just sort of, well, I kind of like parts of what you're talking about. I think I'll incorporate those into my religion. And this Jesus sounds a little bit like Horus in the Egyptian religion. So I think Jesus and Horus are probably the same. And you'd have this, what was called syncretism. People would put sort of mix and match from different religions and put them together. And if you can worship many gods, well, then you can just add Jesus to your pantheon of gods and move on, right? Well, that's not the way Christianity was it? The early Christians wanted to replace polytheism with a belief in one God. And you don't sort of just add our God onto the list with all the others. This was the fullest revelation of God that we had in the world in the incarnation of God in Jesus Christ. So this was an exclusive message. And that's why the early apostles and the early church, it was important for them to clear up the confusion and help people recognize who this Jesus was. Jesus was divine, fully divine. But there were some who said, yes, we believe that. We know that he was divine. What we don't believe is that he was human. All this stuff about him getting crucified and hung on a cross and dying. God doesn't die. God does not suffer. God is impassible, they would say. That's a big philosophical word that means that God doesn't suffer stuff. God is above and beyond all our human suffering because God is so almighty and great. So for you to say that Jesus was divine and that he died on a cross is just like, we don't get that. Paul says it's a stumbling block to the Greeks, and it was. So many of the Greeks, they believed that Jesus was divine, but they didn't believe that he was human. Then you had some others who thought, well, yeah, I know this guy. He was a carpenter, right? Didn't he grow up in Nazareth? Yeah, we believe that he's human. We just don't believe that he was divine. Maybe he was like adopted by God as his son, you know, because he was such a good guy. God blessed him and adopted him, but he wasn't like God. So there were those folks, too, who thought he was human but not divine. And so you have the apostles drawing together some of the basic and fundamental beliefs about Jesus Christ. And that's really what gave birth to the Apostles' Creed. And you'll note that the paragraph about Jesus is the longest one, right? Because that's the one that they were really trying to focus on and get straight. So that when this gospel spread out throughout the world and telephone was going on, that there was something to come back to, the original message, that there was an authoritative standard for what it meant to be a follower of Jesus. And that's where the Apostles' Creed came in. You remember that The creed says that Jesus suffered under Pontius Pilate. Do you ever wonder why on earth it says that word suffered? It's because there were people at that time who believed that God could not suffer, let alone die and be buried. That's why those words are in the Apostles' Creed, to help people know, no, he did suffer. No, the nails were real. No, the agony was real. It wasn't just sort of an act. It wasn't something that God shielded him from, or that God just sort of was above all that. Jesus suffered on the cross under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He was fully human and experienced the world the way we experience the world. That's an important truth that the Apostles' Creed needed to underline. But then also, where did he come from? What's his origin? He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. That origin tells us that he was divine, that his origin was from God, conceived by the Holy Spirit. Holy cow! This person is not just some guy who made it, some guy who sort of was so good that God had to recognize him. There was something else going on here. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit. Remember that the New Testament was not collected and drawn together until the 400s AD. So while there were gospels, there were letters that were circulating in the world, the early churches didn't have the Bible as we know it today. They might have a letter here or a gospel there. But it wasn't until the 400s that that was drawn together. So this creed became an important way, an authoritative message for people who were putting the message out there to stay within these bounds, to remember the primary message. And that's what the Apostles' Creed does. Every creed has a context, you know. There's a reason that people put their faith into words. I believe this. There's always a context and a reason for putting that into writing. And for us today, the Apostles' Creed is relevant, although some of the issues have been long settled. So the nature and the person of Jesus Christ is an issue that has been settled in Christian theology for about 1,600 years. So the Apostles' Creed set a standard. And that has been the standard for our church to this day and continues to be that standard for us. But there are other creeds. I don't know if you noticed this, but if you turn in your hymnals, why don't you do this? Turn in your hymnals, if you would, to 880. There are a bunch of creeds back there. In our United Methodist hymnal, we have a bunch of creeds in there. Because each creed, while it deals with an authoritative message about what Christian belief is, each age brings new challenges. Each age brings a need to translate what the Christian faith means in a different age. So if you take a look at the Nicene Creed, for example, that's number 880. It's a long creed, and if you look at that middle paragraph, that's all about Jesus. And they needed to get very specific in 325 AD, which is when this creed was written at the Council of Nicaea and was approved at the Council of Nicaea. People were arguing about Jesus again, right? And one of the key questions that was going on right now was, well, what is the relationship between God the Father and Jesus the Son? I mean, are they the same? Are they different? We're looking at the scriptures that talked about Jesus as the firstborn of all creation. So was Jesus was born, but was the Son eternal or was he created? Was God the Father, how was he begotten? How can he be eternal, but he can also be the Son? Doesn't it mean that God is first? The Father, and then you got the Son, right? Is God number one, Jesus number two? Well, then there's a difference, right? Or when Jesus says, when you've seen the Father, or when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. What did Jesus mean by that? So the Nicene Creed really wrestles with it, and you can see what it spends a lot of time doing. And it's what it's trying to say is, while there's a relationship of Father and Son are all one in the triune God, that Christ was God in the flesh, that the Father came to visit us in Jesus. Take a look at what it says. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light. It's the same thing. See what they're saying? Eternally begotten. What does that mean? How can you beget something, but it's eternal? It has no beginning, has no end. Wow. So this relationship of Father and Son has been eternal. So it's not the way we see it in terms of temporal priority. This is an eternal relationship. Well, I'm getting kind of esoteric here, but you can see that each creed has a question that it's trying to answer. Let's look at another creed. Flip the page over to 883. No, let's look at 884. This is the statement of faith of the Korean Methodist Church. Well, what was going on in the Korean Methodist Church was that Methodists had gone and established a church in Korea many, many years ago. And now, right after World War II, the Korean church was now on its own. It was no longer a missionary church. It was a church of its own right. It spoke in its own language, and the people had embraced it fully themselves, and now Christianity was taking on, the United Methodist Church in Korea was taking on a new identity as a Korean Christian United Methodist Church. Or I shouldn't say United, it was just Methodist. And they still call themselves the Korean Methodist Church. Separate denomination, but same family of Methodist. So after World War II, the world had been devastated by the war. Take a look at what it says, though. What this creed tries to answer is, how should we live? After we've been through this harrowing time of war, how shall we live? And here we have a statement about it. There are the first three statements are about God, about Jesus, and about the Holy Spirit, like any Trinitarian creed. But then look, all the rest is about how do we live knowing that this is true. Why don't you read it with me? We believe in the one God, creator and sustainer of all things, father of all nations, the source of all goodness, beauty, all truth, and love. We believe in Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, our teacher, example, and redeemer, the savior of the world. We believe in the Holy Spirit, God present with us for guidance, for comfort, and for strength. Stop there for a minute. So there we have it, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Just three sentences, because they don't need to go into any more, because this has been established. We're no longer arguing or confused about these three items of the Holy Trinity. We've got it. So now, knowing these things, look at what the Korean church says. Let's read on. We believe in the forgiveness of sins, in the life of love and prayer, and in grace equal to every need. We believe in the Word of God, contained in the Old and New Testaments, as the sufficient rule both of faith and of practice. We believe in the church, who are united in the living Lord, for the purpose of worship and service. We believe in the reign of God, as the divine will realized in human society, and in the family of God, where we are all brothers and sisters. We believe in the final triumph of righteousness and in life everlasting. Amen. There is a sense in which salvation now is not just for individuals, but for society as well. There's been a world war, and in the midst of that horrible evil, that was defeated. There's a sense in which God is working through these events to unite our world into his kingdom. There is that sense in which salvation doesn't just come to individuals, but it comes to the world. And that's what God is up to. And there is this beautiful vision of God's kingdom filling the world as the waters cover the sea. One other creed, just look up right up above where we were, a statement of faith of the United Church of Canada. This is maybe the most recent creed, and it comes to us from the United Methodist Church in Canada. But the Methodist Church in Canada has united with Presbyterians and United Church of Christ and Lutherans to form what's called the United Church of Canada. And so when they all came together, all those Protestant denominations came together, they came up with this creed. But what's the issue? What's the context that inspired this creed, besides these denominations all coming together to speak an important synopsis of their faith? What is behind this story? Let's read through it. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church. We celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. Well, there are some things that are going on here, like God is the creator, but also is creating. Isn't that interesting that as science teaches us more about how the world is constantly changing, that tectonic plates are still moving out in California and all over the world, and the earth is still taking shape, there's this understanding that God didn't just create once, but God is creating every day in us and in the world. But the way this creed begins and the way it ends responds to a very modern problem. The number one fear of modern people is not death. The number one fear of modern people is, do you know? Loneliness. Being alone. And notice how this creed begins and how this creed ends. So it's a statement of faith, but it's also a statement of faith that is pointed toward its time and one of the chief fears of the people, being alone, being left alone, dying alone. Here, this statement of faith says very boldly, very profoundly, beginning and ending, we are not alone. God is there. That's the message that we need to hear. Okay, well, the Apostles' Creed, let's get back to that. The Apostles' Creed is that authoritative creed for us. And so authoritative that I have always used the Apostles' Creed in my confirmation classes to structure the classes around. And in fact, I have my confirmands finish their class. Now, this is not a recommendation, confirmands, so don't get nervous. But the way I have the confirmands finish their class was to write their own creed. It begins, I believe, and then what you think is most important about your faith, and list it there and distill it into a paragraph or two. It's a great way for each of us to talk about our elevator speech. Have you heard about your elevator speech, right? You know what that is, don't you? Well, you know that if you're in business and you've got a proposal and you might only have 30 seconds in the ride up the elevator with your boss, he might give you this much time to hear about your proposal. You need to be ready at any moment to witness to your faith in that 30-second elevator ride when someone might ask you, what is the hope that you have within you? How would you distill it? How would you boil that down to what is most important and most essential to your faith? It's not a bad exercise, not just for confirmands, but for everybody. In fact, I'd love to see Pastor Phil get a whole bunch of letters from his people, his congregation, writing him a note. By the way, Pastor Phil, here's my personal creed. It doesn't have to be authoritative for anybody else, but for you. An expression of your faith. Wouldn't that be fun to just litter his desk with your personal creeds? A good exercise, too. But let me just say one more thing. Martin Luther said that faith is not the same thing as assent. Do you know what that means, assent? It means saying yes. So faith is not just saying yes to the Apostles' Creed. Yep, that's what I believe. Faith goes deeper than just words. Faith goes deeper than just saying, yep, I agree. Faith equals trust, according to Luther and later to John Wesley. That tells me two things. First, that faith is as belief, as in I believe, is personal. Faith is personal. It has to be personal. Not like you and that creed, but you and another person. For example, when you come to buy my car for $2,000 and you write that check out for $2,000 and hand it to me, if I have faith in you, I'm not going to call the bank to make sure the check is good. I'm going to let you drive off with your new car. That's what you call faith in a person, right? Kind of like what Doris Grody had in me when I was holding that rattlesnake. Her belief, I believe in you, Pastor Paul, was personal. I believe in you, Pastor Paul. The other thing is that belief is active. It isn't just something that we say words about. It's something that changes the way we behave. I was asked to, one of my confirmation kids was a Boy Scout, and he was on a camp out, and they had built this rope bridge across a ravine. This is a pretty serious ravine. It's like about 50 feet up in the air. These boys had thrown ropes across, tied knots, and they had this rope bridge cross. Now, I was supposed to come and inspect it. And I looked it over and I checked some of the knots, you know, I looked at it and they told me how they did it and all that. And I said, I give you guys an A+. I believe that is an awesome bridge. And you know what's coming though, right? That was not enough for them, was it? It was not enough. I had to get on that rope bridge and go across that ravine. That's what belief is, see? It's not just words. It's action. It's action. So, the Apostles' Creed, while it's the authoritative teaching for our church, for our worship, ultimately what matters most is, do you trust the one that the creed describes? Do you trust God the Father Almighty, never to leave you, never to forsake you? Do you trust that waiting Father that Jesus describes, who's waiting there, even though you have journeyed to a far country with a robe and a ring of sonship or daughtership waiting for you to come home? Do you believe in that God? Do you trust Jesus, who lived for us, who died for us, who was raised on high and lives again for us? Do you trust his promise that love is stronger than hate? That evil is to be overcome by good? That inasmuch as you serve the least of these, my brothers or sisters, you are doing it unto him? Do you believe that? Do you live that? Does it change your life? Do you trust in the Holy Spirit and live differently because of Jesus' promise that the Holy Spirit is coming and will come with healing, with forgiveness, and with power? Oh, I can see I'm going late. You're going to turn my microphone off in a minute, aren't you? Let me tell you just one more story. There were two members of the church that I served in Newton. Their names were Jack and Pat Howe. They were up the backbone of that church in Newton. They were the people who are always in the front of the church, whether they're greeters or not, they would welcome you. They were the ones who would throw parties for new members and get people together and knowing each other, and they were irreplaceable. They were wonderful. One day, they stood up in church during Joys and Concerns time, and they said, "We've been talking about it, we've been praying about it, and we've decided to sell our house. And we're going to go down to the Heifer Project Ranch in Arkansas, and we're going to live down there and work down there full time." What? What? You mean you're really like taking Jesus seriously about selling all your goods and going to follow him? He didn't really mean it that way, Jack, Pat. That's what everybody told them. Even their pastor had serious questions, but they did, because they believed, they trusted the promises of God that when you are called by God to serve and even to sacrifice, that there is waiting for you something that will make it all worthwhile. They trusted in that promise. They believed in that promise. Like Doris Grody, to say credo, to say I believe, means this is the way I live. I believe is to say more than just ancient words that are printed on a page. To say credo is to put your life in the hands of the living God, trusting that God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit will keep his promises now and forever. Amen? Amen. Amen. All right. Well, I believe do we have a hymn? We have an offering, don't we? We have a hymn. Here we go. I found where we are. Let's stand and sing. 85. Thank you. You may be seated. Are there joys or concerns we lift up in prayer this morning? Joys or concerns? Yes. Katie Mitchell is an aunt. Naya? Anaya is in the world. We give thanks for a new birth. Others? Yes.
One Bella Mitchell. I don't know what her condition is right now, but she's struggling. Lives in the back, you can tell you more.
Ellen
Nistel.
Okay. For Ellen, yes?
I just want to say I have a joy that I am able to be back
Your name? Connie?
Alan.
Connie's back. Connie's back. All right. Thank you, Connie. Other joys or concerns? But over here. Yes.
Michelle Fildering.
I think you all know, don't you? I'm clueless, but you know. And she and her father's back in the hospital. Okay, all right. A special joy and thanks for your music. The choir was lovely today. And for our piano player and for the sound crew back here that makes everything work so smoothly. God bless you. For so many volunteers who make this happen, God bless you all. Yes, one more. Wayne Huggins passed away. So for his family. All right. Let's pray. Oh, wait. Way back here.
Yeah. My wife and I put an offer on a house.
Wow. So you have an offer. You put in an offer.
They accepted.
And they accepted. So it's like you've got a house. We won't go that far. Awesome. So like, does it, are you superstitious or can we thank God for where you are so far? Okay. All right. Let's pray. Almighty God, we pause and are reminded how frail life is. For those who mourn this day, we pray for your comfort and help us to be ministering angels to answer our own prayers, to bring comfort to those who mourn right now. For those who are ill or confined to the hospital bed, we ask for your healing presence and that you might work through doctors and nurses and that you might work through us as we visit, encourage, and pray to bring healing, wholeness, and health to these folks we love. We are so grateful for homecomings, returns, and as Thanksgiving comes around, we look forward to families reunited, and we pray for safe travel for those who are coming from long distances. We thank you for dreams. We thank you for a vision for our future and for opportunities that come, like homes. Homes that we own, or at least the bank owns for a while, and then we eventually own. What a beautiful thing. Lord, we give you thanks for all these things and ask that even as we state our belief in you, we pray that prayer of the Father, Lord, I believe, but help thou my unbelief. When we doubt, when our actions don't fully manifest what we hold in our hearts, forgive us and strengthen us anew, for another day has come. And may we, inspired by your presence and the power of your Spirit, to go into the world to act boldly for you and in your name. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ. And all the people of God said, Amen. I think we have an offering this morning, so I'd like to ask our ushers to wait upon us for this morning's offering.
Our dear gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the great love that you have for us and all the blessings and gifts that you bestowed to us. Please accept our love, our service, and our gifts back to help you do your will on earth. In Jesus' name we pray with grateful hearts. Amen.
Let's pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our final hymn is number 438 in the hymnal. Whenever I had a guest speaker come in and preach when I was gone, I always prayed that they would go long because they always went short and people would always rub it in when I came back. Oh, they were real short, Pastor. Maybe you could learn something from them. Well, so I've just done your pastor a big favor. I just want you to know that. It was hard, but I tried my best. Thank you for your patience, and thank you for letting me share worship with you today. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the Father, and the fellowship of God's Holy Spirit now dwell with you and go with you now and always. And all the people of God said, Amen.